Hello and welcome to Create and Craft. Lovely to have your company. This morning is a great morning because, of course, it is the start of Jennie Rayment's classroom. You're not going anywhere. You're here for the whole day, which is brilliant. And now, of course, every time we have Jennie here and we have the classroom, this is a chance for you to see a step-by-step guide. It's almost like a how-to guide.
Very much so. So press record now.
Yeah, or work along with Jennie.
No, they have to sew pretty quick.
I know.
Pretty quick, because I've got to do
But they're good. They're good.
Oh, they're there.
Get everything ready. So should we have a look at some samples here? Jennie's going to be making a waistcoat. We've actually got waistcoat patterns as well on the show. If we have a look at some of the samples here, they're absolutely gorgeous.
Thank you.
They really are beautiful. Of course, you know, with your fabrics, I love the fact that we've got...
This is one made from old bits of silk ties.
Yes.
Without any twiddling and fiddling. This is the back of one that's got some of the things that I usually do when I'm not teaching patchwork. My usual thing is twiddling and fiddling.
Yes.
Coming down here towards these.
And if we move over.
Yeah. We've got one made in denim and a stripy fabric mixed. One I've worn a lot. They've seen it many times on the show.
Yes.
And that's one of the techniques, making tucks, I'm going to be doing this morning. Then we've got next door to it the bias effect on the black and white one.
That's a lovely monochrome, isn't it?
Yes. Turn this round. It's got these things called trumpets. So I'm covering that technique and that technique this morning.
Yeah.
And then moving on, that's just a selection of another calico waistcoat, one done using a trip round the world method that I did last classroom, and the back of a sort of tabard type thing.
Yeah.
And the same method that I use for doing the garments, which I call stitch and slip or quilt as you go, is also used for making the landscapes, which
it's
we have
lovely,
here.
Lovely, isn't it?
So although we're not doing a landscape,
the
technique for stitching it, and indeed tucks and things are used on the landscape, you will learn a technique for doing that sort of thing as well.
Beautiful. I love it. I really do. So moving down now,
This is the waistcoat, Jackie.
Right.
And the waistcoat we've got here features a panel of tucks down the front, and I will briefly explain how the embellishment gets done. And then on the back of it, we have got the bias effect.
Oh, that's lovely, isn't it?
And some things called trumpets. These are sort of one of my signature things. I like that word, signature.
Yeah, of course.
And they're made from literally folding squares. And all this is a bias strip, folded, stitched down, and the edge rolled back. And people often say, oh, is this cathedral windows? No, it's not.
Right.
But it has a very similar appearance to cathedral windows because of that arc.
Yes.
Now, that's made with the fabric we've got, and I work in cotton. I'll talk more about
Good.
These later.
Okay.
There is another waistcoat here, just to show the other choice of fabric, where I've done very different. I put some patchwork on the back. I've just used a very simple technique, but when you understand how easy you can do this, and we'll be doing this on the 2 o'clock show, you'll see how the templates make life extremely simple. And indeed, we've got a heart-shaped template, which could be used to make a heart-shaped pocket, or indeed could be used for a heart applique, or you could make a bag, etc., etc.
That's really lovely, isn't it?
But the black and cream one is the one we're doing this morning.
This morning is this one.
Yep.
Okay, great. So stay tuned. It's all coming up and it's going to be a fantastic classroom. Okay, shall we have a look at some of the fabrics? Because we saw two of those waistcoats.
Yes, we did.
We've got the fabrics here, actually.
We have indeed, and they're great cotton fabric, aren't they? I mean, the waistcoats we're doing, you could do it for your husband, you could do it for yourself, your husband could make it for you. They are for male or for female.
Yes.
I can see someone's husband wearing that. I mean, wouldn't that be fantastic?
So
disco party,
nice
et cetera, et cetera. You could line it with those two.
I love it. So we've got the two options. This is your multicoloured. So you can see there the butterflies and dragonflies.
And there's a metre of that.
Really
that
lovely.
Will be the
That's
main
a whole metre.
Colour
yes.
for the waistcoat. And then the accent, so it's a good word, that accent,
yes.
will be either the pale blue and the green,
or
some and some, or you could line it with it. So there's 2 metres of fabric there, a metre of the main colour and 2 half metres of the other two.
That's lovely. So that is your multi. And then, of course, you've got your brown option. These are lovely.
They're very much me colours.
Yeah.
I'm great.
Neutral.
They're neutral.
Sort of, yes.
I like black, and black is very flattering.
Yes.
And of course the cream is nice. It brings a light bit to it, and
yes.
I do like the little subtle stripe on that.
Me
so
too.
I chose to use those because without doubt the textured designs that I'm doing this morning do show up very well in these fabrics, but the patchwork designs we'll look at the
yes.
2 o'clock show will work well in the other. But
I love them. And remember, they're both the same item, number 279158, either the multi or the brown.
That's
very
a
popular
jolly good
for the
price
for the brown.
For 2 metres of fabric.
It is, and quality cotton
Quick.
As well.
I'm having another one of
no,
those.
No, put it back. And let's have a. Oh, this is.
I used all mine.
I know. This is a great bundle here. And it's part of our Mayhem price
really?
As well. Yes,
because that's got some cracking prices on the Mayhem
oh,
thing.
Yes. So bank holiday Mayhem prices. Normally, this is just under £50. Look at that club member price there, £34.19. And we've got FlexiPay. Two
wow.
interest-free FlexiPay.
You can everything else
seven...
on the show.
Yes.
Yes.
£17.10. I love this one because, again, I love the fact that it's nice and easy to store as well.
It's easy to store. It folds up. It does your bias cut. And you can use that for your bias tape, the bias tape machine, making the bias. It takes the hard sums out of things. So that's for your bias. And the other two templates do half square and quarter square triangles. Great for patchwork. Great for borders. Great for blocks. Great for people who, if they want to begin patchwork and they
yes.
need a couple of templates other than a square, those two work.
Brilliant. 279311 is your item number there. And remember, you've got FlexiPay option available. That means you can open up your Flexi basket. So if you open up your Flexi basket, maybe you want to pop some books in there. And again, we've got a great price on these.
I'm dreading what the price is. What is
£24.29.
I think this is outrageous. Those books should cost you round about £30. So they're saving big time.
I know. I'm sorry, Jennie, but it's too late. So here you go. So this is your first of two books, and they are great. And step by step, guys, that's your tucks and textures too. And then of course you've got your tucks, textures, and pleats.
Now that's a reissue of the book I initially wrote that's
yes.
sort of made my claim. But we'll be talking about that within the classroom. And indeed, that's got the details on it, how you begin a textured garment, etc., etc. And that's a cracking price, that.
It really is, for both of them, £24.29 if you're in the club. So, 279323 is the item number there. So let's have a look at this, because Jennie is just Jennie, and we love her, don't we? I love the fact that we have got this whole bundle here, and this is almost like, I would say, I mean, when Jennie, have you seen this? When
this
Jennie pulls that out.
The telescopic.
I thought it was just your pointer that you were just...
Well, no. You see, it folds up like a pen.
Yes.
And this is one of the things in the Notions bundle. And what it is it's magnetic. OK, so you have dropped your pin. Pick it up. You have dropped your screwdriver, your quilting guide on the floor. You can just pick it up. There you are.
Oh!
See? The whole
that is a,
lot.
That is a
now,
strong magnet.
This is fantastic, particularly as perhaps you can't bend to
yes.
touch the floor. My husband, whose corpulence now sort of slightly overhangs his feet, means that he can easily pick things up that
yes.
he drops on the workroom floor.
Yeah, that's
so
really
great
good.
Tool. That so that's one
and
of the
very
things
strong
in very
as well.
Strong.
Very strong yes. magnet. So you get that in the set, and I do love the magnetic needle
yes.
keeper as well.
If you've got children, grandchildren, anybody in the house, dogs, animals, pets, you must keep your needle safe, and this is magnetic. So
yes.
when you finish with the needle, show with the pin.
Yeah.
It will stick in there.
Yes.
And it means you can't drop it on the floor. It
That's
can't
right.
get in the carpet. It can't get into the environment. A magnetic needle keeper is very useful to
That's
have.
That's nice. It's nice and a nice compact as well. And then, of course, you've got your disappearing ink pen
right. this
in that set.
This will disappear between 48 to 72 hours.
Okay.
So don't write checks with it, because 3 days later it'll have vanished. It is useful because it just goes away by itself.
Good
marking.
You don't have to keep
it,
rub it, you don't
have
to wash it,
it.
You don't have to think about
no,
that.
It just goes away very quietly when it's gone, when it's finished.
I love that. And then the clear fabric grabbers, of course.
Stop your rulers
yes.
from sliding.
Yeah.
And they also fit fairly flat so the ruler doesn't cockle. And then my favourite pins.
I love these.
These
yeah,
are
I
the
love
best
these flower
pins.
Head pins.
Fantastic.
Yeah, they really are great. So that whole bundle, £8.99. 279330 is the item number there. You're getting all the essentials there. So we have a look at these patterns. So we've got this pattern bundle, and again, all the waistcoats there. I mean, that is a great price. It really is.
Wow.
Because
you've
great
got
price?
Patterns there that will do waistcoats for everybody.
That's right.
It's all a variety of different sizes. It'll do the men, it'll do the ladies, it'll do large children if you wish.
Yes.
I thought it was really good, and from what I like from a textured point of view, is one of them is ace for making a textured waistcoat from. But the others are equally great for the disco waistcoat, the party waistcoat, the wedding waistcoat, because so many people these days like to have the matching waistcoat.
I love waistcoats. I wear waistcoats all the time.
It keeps your back warm.
Yeah. But also with this, like with this style, you could almost, you know, make almost like a gilet.
Yes. Yes.
Because you have got
nice
all the options.
Nice shaping on that pattern.
Very nice shaping. This should be £17.97 for these three, 279345. It's just £10.79. I think it's a brilliant price for all three patterns there, and they're easy to follow, male and female as well, which I absolutely love. 279345 is the item number there. Busy for these already as part of our Mayhem event. That's a great price. Now let's have a look at this sewing interfacing.
Right. This
is 1 metre squared.
Why I need it. All right, I'm going to keep nothing more about it. They've got to watch the classroom to see why you need the interfacing.
Okay. Right. £2.69, 1 metre squared there. 280015 is the item number there. Then of course we've got our wadding.
Yep. Fluff. Wadding or batting. Now, it confuses people because the Americans don't speak quite the same English. And in Americanese, this is batting. In English, it's wadding.
Wadding,
but basically, it's fluff. It's a very nice substance to work from. It's cotton. It washes well. It's lovely to machine quilt on. It's nice to work on. And it makes great waistcoats. So you need one of those as well as the interfacing.
Right. And that is 72 inches by 90. £15.29. 252259 is the item number there. And one of our favourites as well is the True Cut, because when you look at this and you've got all the markings on it that you need, you're going to get accuracy as well, aren't you, Jen?
And you need, and it's straight, and you've got lines on it you can use for marking various things. You can grip the fabric through the holes. It bends so that it doesn't break anywhere near so easily, and it works with the True Cut system. So anyone who's got dexterity issues considerably easier.
Because you can see here, if you you can just sort of see the edges there. So using your True Cut,
let's put the cutter on here. The cutter then fits on the groove. On the wrong way around. There you are.
Yeah.
And slides up the edge there. And of course, you can't wobble and fall off. You are firmly fixed on the edge.
Yes.
So it acts as a very good guide, which makes for greater accuracy. And the cutter itself has a lovely ergonomic handle and can be easily made right or left. So for those people who suffer with rotary cutting, that one really does work.
Great. So that's your ruler, 203628. Then, of course, you've got your True Cut. You can see that on the website. And let's have a look at the scissors. Then, of course, you've got those great scissors. I love the fact that these are nice and wide with the blades. £22.99, or £20.69 if you're in the club. 25 centimetre. And, of course, this is a great brand as well and really great quality. 276578 is the item number there.
Look at those shears.
Look at that.
And they've got a screw on them so you can adjust them.
That's
and they're made with high quality German steel. Excellent pair of shears. They make that lovely
Yeah, I love the sound. Noise. And then, of course, you've got your mini iron. Now, this is always very popular.
Not surprised.
Really, really popular all the time. £39.99 is that price. And we're offering this on FlexiPay as well. In the club, it's just £35.99. And of course, with FlexiPay, that means you can spread the cost to interest-free FlexiPays of just £18. And very quickly, let's have a look at the sewing machine. So the Husqvarna, 32 built-in stitches, practical stitches, decorative stitches, nice and easy to use. Husqvarna, we know, is a great machine. Been going for many, many years for schools, colleges, professionals.
It's a great machine for either taking to class because it's lightweight and got a carrying handle. It's inexpensive, so if you're beginning sewing and you want a machine that's going to do your dressmaking things, it's going to make your curtains, it's going to do your patchwork, it has all the stitches you want, it comes with a quilting guide, you get a spare set of needles, it does excellent buttonholes, and it's a really nice, neat little machine you can just tuck away, and it's not going to break the bank.
I think it's a brilliant price as well. Don't be fooled by that price. You're getting everything that you need. The needle
and
threader.
Price, it's a very good
it's
price.
It's a very good
very,
price,
very
isn't
very
it?
Good price.
Normally it's £180, and I love the fact that we've got the one-step buttonhole as well that we can do. So it's nice and easy. 276786 is the item number there. Remember, we've got three FlexiPays on offer there of just £41.70. This is brilliant. Get it while you can. Remember, once you get this, if you get this, then everything you get on the show, you put it into three FlexiPays, which makes it really lovely. You can jump onto the website, remember. On the website, you see everything that we've got on the show. Also, you'll see previous or prior, if you like, classrooms by Jennie. It's all there. on the website, all the www.createandcraft.tv. And I love the fact that we've got the previous classrooms, and of course today's classroom will be featured on there in due course. Okay, so we're back here, and I hope you're ready to join us, and I hope you are joining us, and welcome if you've just joined us. You're just in time, because not only do we have great products on the show, but of course this is Jennie's classroom. So it's over to Jennie.
Right, folks, are you sitting there? Have you eaten up your Wheaty Bangs? Now, private message for William. Sit up straight and eat your breakfast. And next time you feel like waking me up at 2:45 in the morning, don't. All right? Dear little one, he's only 3. OK, we are going to make a waistcoat today. And we showed you 2 lots of fabric. There was the multicoloured version, which I'm not going to use for this particular show because I'm using the brown and tan one. But if you choose to use this, wherever I use black, you would use the purple. And wherever I use the cream or the mid-tan, you would use one of the other 2. And you could make your waistcoat exactly the same as the one I'm doing in this colourway if you so chose. So I've chosen to use this particular colourway. And the waistcoat we're making is this one. It's one that has a panel of tucks down the front, and I will be showing you how to make tucks. On the back, we have something called trumpets and something called the bias effect. To make the waistcoat, you are going to need a pattern. And we've got 3 patterns in our pattern bundle. The one that I'm using is this one here. Now, they come in multi-sizes, and I have to confess that when I use a pattern these days, what I like to do is to make my own copy of the size of pattern that I've chosen to use. So I will literally trace off onto greaseproof paper, baking parchment, whatever, the pattern size that I want to use, which is great, because it means that if I get a little larger, or indeed get a little smaller, then I can always use one of the other pattern sizes. Or indeed, if I want to use it with somebody else, I haven't hacked it up. And if anyone can tell me how to get the pattern back into the bag the same way as it came, I'd be delighted, because no matter how carefully you fold it, it never goes back. Now, the waistcoat pattern I've chosen to use is this one. Reason being is there are no sections down the front, shapings down the front at all. It's nice and plain. I am aware it has darts, or meant to have darts on the back, but I'm ignoring the darts, simply because on a padded waistcoat, darts would be very wodgy. That's a typical English word for you, means thick. So I'm using the waistcoat because I like its nice, simple front. If you chose to make a quilted waistcoat using one of the other ones, perhaps this one, for instance, there's no reason why you couldn't cut the pieces out, allow a little extra, lay it onto the wadding, do your quilting being the action of anchoring the fabric to the wadding, then cut the pieces out carefully and stitch the waistcoat together. And to get rid of any excess bulk in the seams, I'd press the seams open and flat and possibly top stitch them. So there's no reason why you can't do a quilted waistcoat with any of these patterns. And the patterns are for men and for women. So I've chosen this one. Now, whenever I make a waistcoat, I make my waistcoat using a layer of interfacing. And the reason for using the interfacing is I can draw the pattern on the interfacing. You'll find in Tucks, Texts and Pleats, which was the first book that I wrote, in the back is a little bit about how you make a garment and various bits of information about how you make the garment. I draw the interface on the interfacing, the pattern, because I can then cut it out and lay it onto the wadding. And the interfacing makes a surface to work on. It also gives me a chance to draw a few guidelines as to where I position the various pieces. Because if you just work straight onto the wadding, sometimes the wadding moves and you've no clue as to where exactly to position the various pieces. Now, strangely enough, exactly the same way of making the waistcoat, stitch and flip. It's also the same way that I would do for a landscape, this same stitch and flip technique. So if you wanted to look at landscapes and know the technique, follow what I'm doing in the class. Okie dokie. Not only do you need the interfacing, but you will need some batting, wadding. And I'm using the hob because it's a really nice material to work on. It's nice to stitch on, it sews very nicely through the machine, you certainly don't need something on the back of it. And what I like about it particularly is being slightly fluffy, it sticks to the various fabrics. So you will need interfacing, you will need wadding, you will need the pattern, and you will need the fabric. How are we going to begin? Well, we're going to begin with by making a tracing of your pattern. So using greaseproof paper, whatever, trace off the pattern. You then need to trace the pattern onto interfacing, and here's one I did earlier. So let me just put those pieces out of the way. We have the pattern design traced onto the interfacing. When I trace it onto the interfacing, I will draw lines on the interfacing that are guidelines for showing me where to put the various textured pieces. Now, remember, if you are going to do a waistcoat, you have a right-hand side and a left-hand side. And please, when you cut the interfacing out and draw the pattern on it, do one for the right and one for the left. Otherwise, you end up with two right-hand sides or two left-hand sides, and that can be problematical. And if you think you've done it, I've done it twice. So, having drawn round the pattern, so if anyone wants two odd fronts, I've got them. I then cut the interfacing out, leaving about an inch or so extra all the way round it. And the reason for that is, as you add the various pieces, the thing contracts a little. And you need to keep the piece of work big enough to be able to put the pattern back on afterwards. Right, having cut your interfacing out, you'll need some wadding to go with it. Move these bits out of the way. And when it comes to cutting the wadding out, this is where those dressmaker's shears are absolutely first class. They go round it like there's no tomorrow. And even though I'm a rotary cutter fan, I still need to have in my workshop a decent pair of shears. And girls and boys out there, hide them, because you don't want other members of your family coming round and using them for cutting the carpet, string, electrical cable, or even cutting the chicken up into small pieces, which I found, which doesn't do it any good. Right, so move number one is prepare the pieces, and we're going to work on the front of the waistcoat. So I've got my pattern traced round onto my interfacing. I then put it onto the wadding. The wadding goes underneath. You will pin it in place. Just put a few pins round the outside of the piece of work. Don't put too many pins in the middle, because otherwise you'll never find them as you add the various pieces. So a few pins just to hold the interfacing to the wadding. Right, move number one is to actually make up the centre panel of tucks to go down the middle. And I'm going to use the cream fabric to do it. If you're working with these fabrics, this is half a metre of the cream. Now, you will find there's a PDF for this on both the Create and Craft website and also on my website. It'll be there tomorrow. When you come to cut your panel of tucks, can you cut your panel of tucks down the fabric so it actually runs parallel to the selvage? And there's a reason for that. So your panel has to be cut out down the fabric. And the reason for cutting it out down the fabric is I'm going to make the tucks down that, and the tucks are going to go with the tight, taut part of the grain. So when I come to flex the tucks, i.e. move them from side to side, I'm working across the fabric, moving with the weft, going from weft to white across the fabric, if that helps you remember. Okay, having cut my strip, I've decided to make four tucks. So I've actually cut a 5.5-inch strip of fabric. If I wanted to make more tucks, say six tucks, I cut a 7.5-inch strip of fabric. And the reason for this is I'm going to mark my fabric out at certain intervals. The first marking is going to be 1.25 inches in from the end, and the second marking is going to be at 1 inch, the third at 1 inch, the fourth at 1 inch, and that should, with luck, leave another 1.25 left. And this is where the ruler is so very useful, because you can put the ruler onto the fabric, align the ruler so that you are marking, it's not enough room on this counter, 1.25 inches, let me get that round that away, in from the edge, there we go, and you can literally use the ruler just to mark across the material. Having marked the fabric, we're going to make tucks. Now, I'm not going to make tucks down that long piece of fabric, because that'll bore you all to tears. I'm just going to make tucks on a very small piece of material. And I've just got a little strip of fabric that I've marked out at the same intervals. What you are going to do initially is to fold the fabric on a set of marks. There'll be a dirty mark either end of the fold. Now, this little sewing machine, it comes with a variety of feet. Ideally, these tucks want to be round about 1/4 inch, but you don't have to be that fussy. If you wanted to have a little nearer a quarter of an inch, this foot would be useful. If you were feeling particularly picky, one of the nice things about this machine is it will take other machines' presser feet. So if you've got a quarter of an inch foot from another machine, you would find that it actually would fit. If you do slightly bigger tucks than a quarter of an inch, don't panic, because the nice thing about this waistcoat is you can always add a bit more fabric on, you can make it a bit larger, there's no hard and fast rules about anything. The seams right gadget, this little gadget here, you will find is very useful for either checking the exact measurement on your sewing machine. It's also remarkably good for buttonholes and for getting very nice mitered corners. So if you haven't got a gadget for measuring your seams, this really will fit the bill. So you can check on your machine exactly what your seam allowance is going to be. Now, with the little Husqvarna, I'll just pull it a little bit nearer to me, it does do a variety of different patterns. I'm just going to use it with its regular foot on, simply to avoid having to change the foot. You, I assume, will be sitting down at the machine. So fold the fabric on a set of marks. Find the foot control, which would be much easier to find when you're sitting at the other table. You are going to proceed down the edge of the fabric, keeping the edge of the presser foot on the fold. And when you get to the bottom, you'll want a little scrap of fabric. You might notice I started off on a little scrap of fabric. So let's just find another small scrap of fabric. This is your thread saver. Fold scrap of fabric in half, so off the main piece of work onto the small scrap. When you are sitting upon the scrap, you will snip behind the presser foot, if I can reach it from this angle. There we are. And I've just made my very first tuck. Now, you might wonder why that scrap was attached at the top here. That's because I was already sitting on a scrap when I began. Now, I sewed to that end. I'm going to turn the fabric round and sew back in the opposite direction. The reason for going up and down the material is to stop the fabric from distorting. So keep it folded on these little marks. When you get to the bottom, there's my scrap waiting for me. You can say, hello, little thread saver. So off the main piece of work, onto the small scrap. Stop sitting upon the scrap, this is all the S's, snip behind the presser foot. It's considerably easier to do it when you're at the right angle. You can't see it from here, there we are. Now, I've done my second tuck, and this is really complicated, isn't it? To do the third one, I'm going to fold the fabric on the next set of marks, and I know the direction I'm going because I'm going towards the dangly bit at the bottom. Sometimes you'll be sewing with the tucks this way, sometimes you'll be sewing with them that way. Don't panic, this is a brainless technique, that's why I can do it. So off the main piece of work there, or down the main piece of work, heading towards me dangly bit at the bottom. It's a great trick, this little thread saver. It saves thread, stops the needle from unthreading, keeps you sewing straight as you come off the end. All right, that was tuck number three. And then finally, tuck number four, I will fold the fabric on the set of marks and sew back. And I'm going to be going towards the dangly bit at the bottom. You would, on your bit of fabric, because it's going to be a long piece, about 20 inches in length, suggest mark it out probably every 5 inches. Right, when you've made your panel of tucks, if you wanted to embellish it, this would be the time to embellish it. Now, coming to the embellishment, I chose to embellish down the front of my tucks using a black thread. And if I bring this over here, you can see the black thread that's down the front here. And I couched it on with the wide zigzag on the sewing machine. You'll find how to do this embellishment in Tucks, Textures and Pleats. It's a bit I've added to the new book. So you embellish your tucks or not. The choice is yours. What do we do next? Right, let's move these bits out of the way. So tucked panel has been made. There is my waistcoat interfacing pin to the fluff. Let's get rid of that because I don't need it anymore. What I'm going to do now is to take the tucked panel and lay it in the centre of the work. And here we are. I put the tucked panel in the very centre of the front here. And this is where you could line it up with the guidelines. Having lain the tucked panel in the centre there, I then cut from the dark tan or mid tan, 2 1.5-inch strips, the full length of my tucked panel. So I simply measured the tucked panel, and here he is, cut my strips the same length, tucks go on the top there, one strip goes one side, and this is where you stitch and flip. You would stitch it on, flip it over. Ditto on the other side, stitch it on, flip it over. Ah, there's my other piece. Stitch and flip. Having done that to the centre, all we now do is cut pieces that fit around the sides of it. Now, at this moment in time, don't panic about your tucks at all. I would have pressed the tucks so the two tucks on either side go towards each other because of the design I'm going to create. So tucks go down the middle, one strip, 1.5 inches wide, gets cut, stitched on, and flipped over. I'll just pin it in place so you can see how it works. So a couple of pins here. This is where you would stitch one pin there, one pin there, and another pin there. And then literally flip it over. And you do exactly the same thing down the other side, stitch and flip. When you have stitch and flipped, or stitch and flopped, it's going to look something like this. And here they are stitched on. Now, word of caution, when you come to make a waistcoat, the more you stitch and the more you pin, the better it will be. So one strip down one side, one strip down the other side. Right, we've got some vacant places to fill in. And this is where, if you get your big ruler, it's so useful this, measure literally the gap that you need to fill. And add a bit more on, don't go OTT, but add a little bit more on. And you need to cut a strip that's going to be big enough to get you from there to there, and another strip to get you from there to there, and then a bit for the very top. Now, word of caution. When you cut your strips and you're making two, one for this half of the waistcoat, one for the other, cut the two strips at the same time and put it to one side. And it does pay to build up the two halves of the waistcoat at the same time. And what you're going to do with this is right sides together, stitch and flip. Another piece to go there. Let's find my other piece. There he is. Stitch and flip. And it doesn't really matter if it's a little bit too large. That'll work. Coming to the shoulder here, what I need for the shoulder is a bit that's big enough to get me from there to the top of the shoulder. So hack a lump off, stitch and flip. When you have stitched and flipped, or stitched and flopped, then you can do some decorative play. And this is where this little machine will come into its own, because it has a variety of stitches that you can use. So you can do anything you happen to fancy. Now, on this piece, here's one I did earlier. This is why I laughed when Jackie said sew along, so I hope you've got to this stage now, all right? Whether we're wiping the sweat from your brow. On this particular sample, just to show you that you can do the tucks without embellishment, I've done 6 tucks, because you might want a larger waistcoat and 4 tucks would be a bit small, and I've done them without any embellishment at all. What I have done on the black areas around is I've done straight tram lines, nice and easy to do, using the edge of the presser foot along the previous line of stitch. I then did a bit of wiggles, because I like doing wiggles, and one of the nice things about this little sewing machine is it comes with a free motion foot, so you can do wiggling. Works a treat. If you wanted to experiment with some of the fancy patterns, now is when you can experiment with the fancy patterns. Once you've done your various bits of stitching, and word of caution, I tend to keep very heavy patterns away from the shoulder seam and also away from the side seams. A, because you don't want extra bulk in the side seams, and B, because you don't want the problem of a really heavy pattern being exactly where you want to sew the seam up in the back. Right, once you've done all the various quilting, that's when you can actually start to play with the tucks. And what I've done with this panel of tucks is I've twisted them one way and back the other. Let me just retrieve my sample from the floor where I threw it. And coming back to this one again, when it comes to anchoring the tucks, if you measure the tucks at X interval and you anchor them all going one direction, then at a second interval, you literally turn the tucks in the opposite direction, you can open them out. And then having them opened out, you can close them back in again. There's no need to press them. I would literally go in, out, shake it all about type of thing. And it depends on the thickness of your tucks as to whether or not you have them very close together or whether you have them far apart. If you've got very thin tucks, you can go close. If you've got very thick tucks, go further apart. So here, I iron them towards each other at the top. At about 2 and a bit inches down, I open them. 2 and a bit inches down, I close them, etc., etc. And this can be your choice. It doesn't have to be anything. You can leave them if you wanted to. Right, once you've made the front, now you go back to your pattern. And this is where you take the pattern piece. Now, little tip with the pattern piece, because I have several of them, it pays to actually write the pattern number on the pattern, because then at least you know which bit belongs to which bit, and you're not going to be rooting through your drawers to find the other half of the pattern. It's at this stage now where I would lay the pattern on top, pin it on, and then draw round the pattern and cut it out. That's where these scissors are absolutely ace for cutting round. If you use a rotary cutter, you are likely to misfire. Now, because I've made it slightly bigger, I can jiggle the pattern to get the pattern really where it is good, because you want to watch the seams, so you don't want to have a seam going through a funny place. And be aware of how big your seam is. Most patterns are 5/8, but there are one or two patterns that are not 5/8. Read the instructions. And I have to confess, I compliment simplicity, because having not seen a pattern, because I'm not a dressmaker, when I opened this pattern, you've got real words on how to do it and proper diagrams. You know, it's vastly improved from the pattern I used about 20 years ago. This one actually tells you stuff in English you can understand. So they get top marks. Once you put the pattern on, you will cut it out. So rather than cut it out, here's one I did earlier. And this is one of the two wrong sides I made. And here is another one of the other two wrong sides I made. So when you do the waistcoat, make sure you have a right and a left. Right, there is the waistcoat front. Let's move on to the back in just a second. We're going to have a word with Jackie, because you're getting awfully bored just sitting there doing nothing.
I'm not at all, Jackie. No, it's fascinating. I love it. It's brilliant. Let's have a look at the patterns, because they are so, so busy on the website and on the phones. 60% of the entire stock now of your patterns have gone. Let's have a look at them. So I think 6036, that's the one that Jennie's using. So that's that pattern. And remember, I'll show you the back. If you just see the back, you're not going to... This is unisex. You've got the unisex, you've got for the misses as well. You've got sizes from extra small right to extra large. It's all there, and as Jennie says, really self-explanatory, nice and easy. You've got all of these three patterns for that brilliant price of just £11.99 or £10.79 if you are in the club. 279345 is the item number there. Let's have a look at your bundle here. I love this. I love the fact that we have got this. Almost looks like a pen, but it's actually a really strong magnet. This is part of your set in Notions. A really great way if you've dropped something on the floor, any pins, your screwdrivers, maybe the foot of one of your feet from your sewing machine. Nice and easy. So you get that in the set. So that's your telescopic magnet. You also get the magnetic needle holder. I like the fact that it comes in that compact as well. And again, really, really strong magnet. And something, you know, we always sort of are losing our pins, etc. It's a nice, easy way of keeping them. Then you've got your disappearing ink. And as Jennie says, it just disappears after about 48 hours. Then, of course, you've got your clear fabric grabbers. And then one of our favourites, the flower head pins. There you go, 75 of there. 40% of the entire stock there has gone. 279330 is the item number there. Then, of course, you've got your wadding. We saw Jennie using that as well during the waistcoat. It's a must to have, and really high quality here also. So 72 inches by 90 inches. That's your heirloom premium cotton batting, or wadding, we call it. 252259 is the item number there. Let's have a look at your true cut quilter's ruler. Again, really a necessity when it comes to quilting. And again, you've got your edges there, so when you use your rotary cutter, you're not going to slip or slide. It really is incredible. You've got your... I love these square sort of holes there, so it's great for gripping also. And then, of course, you've got all of your angles there, all of in sort of quarter-inch increments there. Really beautiful. 203628 is the item number there, and very flexible as well. Should we have a look at some fabric? We've got two options. Thanks, Magic Hand. We've got multi, so you've got 1 metre of your main fabric and then 2 half-metres of your complementary colours, if you like. So that is the multi. And then, of course, we've got the... We've got the browns. I mean, we do have a lighter colour. So again, your main fabric, you've got 1 metre there of your main fabric. And then, of course, you've got 2 half-metres. There you go. of your complementary colours. I just nicked that back from Jennie. So 279158 is the item number there. We have to go back to Jennie because she's got loads to catch up on. Remember, you can find everything that we've got on our website. That's on our website, everything on the show. And, of course, you can see previous classrooms by Jennie. All of them are on our website, all the www.createandcraft.tv. OK, so we're going to move back now to Jennie. We're going to see how to assemble the back of the waistcoat now. So over to you, Jennie.
Right. OK, on the back here, I've drawn round the pattern, cut my interfacing out, allowing about an inch, put some guidelines on it, cut the fluff, pin the things to it. Because I want to have a decorative stitch down the very back of my waistcoat, and if I rescue mine from here, you can see. The trouble is, they don't understand you need space. I just ain't got enough space. So there is the fancy pattern down the back. And the little machine I've got could do a vast range of those sorts of patterns. There's one in particular. You need to cut a 3-inch wide straight grain strip, that's from one side of the fabric to the other. Fold it in half to find the middle and very lightly press it. And that's where something like the clover mini yarn is useful for just lightly pressing. Having pressed a mark down the middle, then sew down the centre using your decorative pattern. If you're working with a decorative thick pattern on a single layer of material, it might pay you to use a stabiliser. And you could use odd bits of the interfacing that was left. You can indeed use a bit of paper, or you can use some other proprietary form of stabiliser. So having done and embellished your straight strip, lay it in the middle of the back of the waistcoat. The bias strips are then formed by cutting your fabric on the bias, and you need to cut a 3-inch bias strip. When it comes to cutting the bias, one of the easiest ways to cut the bias, because people don't always understand about the angle, and this is both right and left-handed, is open your material out. This bias ruler has an angled end. If you place the angled end along a straight side of the fabric, this puts the ruler on the diagonal, on the bias, etc., etc. Cut up the side of the ruler. Now, because I have not got an enormous cutting mat, I'm going to slide the ruler up, recut the fabric and cut up there. So I now know that edge is a biased cut. I happen to want 3 inches. This ruler is exceptionally useful, A, because it folds up, and B, if you want to do biased tape for your tape machine, it will cut all the increments very neatly, and it's marked out for that. But I want a little wider. So having made my bias cut, I'm going to fold the fabric in half on that bias line, and this is where that very nice ruler comes in. Let's fold it in half properly. There we go. And I'm going to measure 3 inches in from that side and cut a strip. So here's my ruler coming in from the edge here, sitting on there, 3 inches in, cut a strip. Guard sits on the edge of the cutter, slide the ruler up the top there, and you've got this nice 3-inch strip. Let's not throw it on the floor because magic hands might need it. Having got this strip, and it will pay you to cut these strips out fairly early on in the procedure, so do the strips next. You are going to press 1 inch over down one long side of both pieces. And the clover little iron is jolly good for doing this. Don't panic, it's not on. Deliberately didn't want to have it on because I know that when I work I get in a mess and I'm going to be bound to knock myself on it. Having pressed the bias edge, what happens now to make that interesting effect down the back is one bias strip gets laid onto the fabric with the folded edge of the bias butted up to the stitching line. The other one goes down the centre. Now, I didn't have time to do one of these earlier because I ran out of fabric. Oh, just didn't have enough for all my show and tell samples. The other one goes down the other side. Now, you're going to stitch these two strips in place using half an inch seam allowance. And that is where this little gadget would come in very useful to measure your half an inch all the way down there. And you could mark the fabric with the invisible pen that disappears. So draw a line half an inch in and stitch all the way down the drawn line. When you've sewn all the way down the drawn line, we're going to make the things called trumpets. And if I just come to this next piece of work, trouble is, you see, is just they're all so big. Let's get this next piece of work out. There we go. Once you've sewn down the middle, and I'll throw this on the floor in the time-honoured way, you have no idea of the mess I get in the studio. Here is my, here's one I did earlier. Here we go. There are the two bias strips stitched down half an inch in from the fold. There's my little bit of decorative stitching peeking out through the middle there. What I'm going to do next is to prepare the panel of trumpets. These are the trumpets. And all the trumpets are two straight cut strips of 3 inches wide and some squares. And how you make the trumpets, let's find my pieces. One straight cut strip, and the straight cut strip is really half the width of fabric. It's long enough to fit vaguely up the side there. You need two strips for each of the panels, so cut two of those twice. To make the trumpets, you will require, I did 3 squares, but you could have more or less. And the squares get folded in half, making a triangle, and then in half again, making a smaller triangle. And what I do with these is I lay them along the edge of the 3-inch strip. Now, you could have them spread out, or you could literally tuck one into t'other, like that. And the more you close them up, the less area you will get. The more you spread them out, the sort of the greater the difference between the shapes they'll be. I closed mine up, so they looked something like this. When you've got them onto that piece of material, pin them in place, okay? Take the remainder of the strip, stick it on top, stitch all the way down there using round about 1/4 inch. It doesn't have to be exact. When you stitched all the way around there, that's when it will pay you to press the seam open and flat, because if you don't, it makes a dreadful wodge. Now, you'll have to have two of these pieces. You want one for that side and you'll want one for the other side. And somewhere I had a, here's one I did earlier. Not quite certain where it's gone to. Stitch this on and flip it back. And these can then be lifted out and played with. If you prefer, there's no reason why you can't play around with these before you stitch them onto the back. And if I am going to play around with them, then what I would do with them is literally take this strip, open it out, flatten it, secure it on the corners with a few small stitches. Now, that's where the little machine is remarkably good, because you have stitch length and width control. So I'd anchor it on the corners there. Let's find another pin, pop one of them there. Right, you've got a little pocket, and there's no reason now why you can't stuff the little pocket. And what I used to go in the little pocket was these small folded sections, and they are done by taking from the cream fabric a little strip, and the strip is 2 inches by 3, but I'll just hack a bit off because I've now covered my cutting mat, so I can't find it with a rotary cutter. To make the little shape, if you fold about 1/2 inch down, it doesn't have to be perfect, then bring one side to touch the middle, ditto on the other side so it makes it like a little sort of aeroplane. Meow. Sorry, I can't resist that. Having done that, this is where the aeroplane's wings hug itself. One side comes in there and one side comes in there, and you get this little shape. Technically, it's a Baltimore rosebud. What I would do with that little shape is stitch across his bottom. Very painful for it, poor thing. But a few stitches across the bottom. This little piece can then be rammed into the pocket, comme ça, and then the edge rolled back. And when you come to stitch the edge down and roll it back, you will end up with something that looks a little bit like this. And here we have the edge rolled back. I stitched it down using the blind hem stitch, which again is another stitch you'll find on the little sewing machine we have beside you, me. And the stitch settings for that will be one on the stitch width and one on the stitch length. And the stitch I would probably use is this one here, that one, under C, one on the width and one on the length. And that would do a really neat little stitch. The idea being the straight part of the stitch goes on the outside, the little bite catches it over. Once you got to that stage, you then fill in the piece this side, the piece that side, and add the shoulder seams. And once more, just as we did with the front, I would do some decorative stitching. Once you've got that on, then you can put the pattern on the top. And put the pattern back on the top, and I've somewhere I've got the pattern hidden underneath this little lot. Where is the pattern? There's the pattern. Pop the pattern back on top, center the pattern with the midline there, cut round. And it's when you've cut it round, then you can play with the bias effect down the middle, because you'll have the idea of the amount of space you've got to work with. And to create those little bobbles, all I did was I anchored the tucks together at, say, 3-inch intervals using a very small stitch length. Having anchored it together, you can then open that and roll it back, and open that and roll it back, and you'll never guess the stitch I would recommend to sew down there. The blind hem stitch. I can see you all shouting it out. Set at 1 and 1 on the little Husqvarna. Okay, so you've got your back done and cut out. You've got your two fronts done and cut out. How on earth are we going to stitch them all together? Simple. Right, now I didn't get round to making a stage sample of this, and if I'm quite honest, I didn't really want yet another waistcoat. As it is, I've got parts for about another 3. Okay, so you have your front. So imagine these are your fronts. Stitch the front to the back on the shoulder seams. And what I like to do with that is, having stitched it together, and remember your seam allowance, is I will press the seam open and flat and then stay stitch either side just to make certain that wodge in the seam lies flat. So you have your front and your back stitched together. Cut out lining exactly the same size, okay? You then put the two pieces together, and this is where it pays to get the bits round the right way. So it's right sides together, don't get this wrong. Having put them right sides together, pin every single little bit, match it up on the shoulder seams. You then start to sew. And here's one I did earlier. And if I'm going to show you the stitching from the lining side, because you can probably see it a little bit more clearly. I sewed, starting in a little bit, all the way round the front of the waistcoat, round the neck, round the neck, round the neck, down the front to the side. And I left a gap. That makes it so much easier when you come to sew it together. I also sewed round here and round the armhole. Now, this is pretty clear on the pattern if you don't get a chance to fully understand what I'm doing. And I stitched the back together. The idea being is that you actually turn the waistcoat through the side seams. Now, don't try bright ideas and think, oh yes, I'm sure I can do it another way. I have tried every other which way to do it, and I'm afraid this, for me, actually works. So if you now turn it through the side seams, and let's just turn it quickly through the side seams, pull it through, you will find on the very small sizes of waistcoat that if you haven't trimmed your seams back properly after putting it together, it might be quite a tug to get it through the side seams. And it's quite a tug to get through the side seams because this is only small. Once you've turned it through the side seams, and I'm determined to do it, and I've got very little time left, work very fast. That's it. There we are. Pull it through there. So you're pulling one front through one shoulder seam. Shove your hand up inside it and sort it out. This will be a marvellous way. I tell you what, we can give this away on the 2 o'clock show. Yes, you see someone's waistcoat for a teddy bear. And let's find the other one. There we go. Nearly there. So if you might find that when it comes to pushing it through, something like using the back of a wooden spoon or the top, not the pointy end, of a firm knitting needle is quite good for pushing the waistcoat front through the shoulder seams. That's it, nearly there, nearly there. Don't use your scissors, no, because you might put off the points in. There we go. And before I forget, I have to say a big thank you to Kieran, because he actually got the wiggly piece in my ear incorrect. So, well done. It's the first time ever I've actually done a classroom when I've heard every word I'm supposed to hear. So, amazing. Right, having turned it through, what I would suggest you do now is that you give it a real good press. And I join the waistcoat together by joining the seams of the front of it. This is the front, in case you haven't guessed. And there is the front. And I will join the seams together, peel the lining back to your sewing machine. You will do this amazingly well, but at this angle, it's very, very difficult to do. But if I just show you the rough how-to, under there, find the, let's up the stitch length in case I have to undo it, which I probably will. There we go. And proceed to sew in orderly fashion all the way along. Once you've sewn in orderly fashion all the way along to there, you can then, this is going to be very badly sewn, so don't think I usually sew like this. That's it, there we go. Cut that off there. Having joined these together, I would then open this out, top stitch it, and then you can, let's get rid of my thread saver, which is attached at this end. There we go. Then you can literally lap the lining over like that and slip stitch it in place. And that on my waistcoat is the only bit I actually did by hand. And I did do it fairly neatly because it's going to be on the camera. See, you can't even see it. So there you go. In a nutshell, how you make a waistcoat. And I think that, Jackie, this won't fit you, this purple one. And it's not the colour for you.
I love it. Everything that Jennie's used is obviously on our website, including the patterns, including, of course, a fantastic sewing machine, and, of course, things like your fabric, your acrylic sets as well, your scissors there, and, of course, the books, the tuck textures too, and tuck textures and pleats. Everything is on our website. The fabric is absolutely delightful. It really is high quality as well. Remember, we've got two different varieties, if you like. We've got the multi, and, of course, we've got the brown. And when you look at the samples there of the waistcoats, they're absolutely
anything with it. I mean, the one I've got on, I've got embellished tucks down the front, I've got the bias effect, so they've seen how you do that, they've seen how you can do that. We've got trumpets on the back.
Oh, yes.
Where
I like
twisted one way. And all it is a square, Jackie.
Yes.
A square folded diagonally and diagonally again, stuck in a seam, and there you are.
I love it. There's just, you're brilliant. Now, you're back at
12 o'clock. With our Dean doing Stuffy Puffy, what's it?
Stuffy Puffy with Dean at 12. And then we're back at 2. What would you do at 2?
Right, well, 2 o'clock we're going to show how to use the heart-shaped template.
Oh, yes.
Which I've done for heart-shaped pockets here.
Yes.
We're going to also show how you use the two other templates that come with this Mayhem bundle that includes this.
So, you know, that's what do they show so far? Rubbish.
You need to lie down.
It was getting up. Are you still watching, William? Hello.
So this is the bundle that Jennie's talking about. This is a really brilliant bundle. Normally, this is just shy of £50. Look at that price, £34.19. And again, high quality. And I love the fact we've got all the angles in there. Everything is marked really clearly. 279311 is the item number there. £34.19 if you're in the club. And, of course, we've got FlexiPay on that. Two interest-free FlexiPays, which is £17.10. If you love quilting, if you love Jennie, have a look at the website. We have got gorgeous quilting classrooms there from Jennie, some previous classrooms that you've done here at Create and Craft. And, of course, there on the website is where you can find everything that we've got on show. And Jennie is a fantastic... I love the way that you must have been a supermodel.
No, I wasn't.
Obviously, look.
Just good at whacking things together. So there you go. Give it a twirl.
I love it.
Stay
with us. Coming up next, Dean's here with our Ruth. So remember, we've got loads here on Create and Craft. Jennie, I shall see you very soon.
Look forward to it.
Take care. Bye-bye.